Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
That we are headed into Hebrews chapter number 11. All right, my goodness. Now, for those of you that are joining us for the first time, you're wondering, why is that a clap and a shout? And the reason why is because we go line upon line, precept upon precept. So we've been in the book of Hebrews, and we've been going verse by verse, line upon line, precept upon precept, just building our faith, building our understanding from the Word of God. And it has taken us 3 years to get to this point. And so I don't know how long we're going to be in Hebrews 11 chapter, but it is a dynamic part of the Word of God. And so we've got some great things that are ahead of us. Today, I want to start a series that we're calling Defining Faith. This is part number one, Defining Faith. Hebrews 11 chapter, you'll notice, is called the Faith chapter, or you've heard it called the Hall of Faith. And so today, we're going to start out basic lessons from the Word of God about defining faith. What is it? In this series, we're going to find out what faith is. We're going to find out how faith comes. We find out how to be led by faith, how to build our faith. Some different things as we go along. So today, part number one is defining faith. Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number one says this. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So we, right off the bat, see that if we're going to have faith, that we've got to have something that we're hoping for, right? Because faith is the substance of things hoped for. See, maybe you're in this place today and you came in and you're hoping for a better life, hoping for children to be raised up in the ways of the Lord, hoping that God will prosper you and bless you in business and in your finances. Maybe you come into this place and you're hoping that God will use you to do something great and mighty on the earth, be a witness and a testimony of Jesus Christ. Maybe you have a hope in your heart to finally break loose and break free from those things that have held you back. Whatever it is that you came in today believing God for, hoping for, faith is the substance of things hoped for, and it is also the evidence of things not seen. See, when you believe in God for something, you're not going to be able to see it. You're not going to know exactly how it's going to work out. You're not going to know what the plan is or the easy steps to creating what it is that you need for your life. That's where faith comes in, and faith takes the unseen and brings it into the natural realm. Now, as I was looking at this, more than just a definition of faith, really it shows in this verse, Hebrews 11 chapter verse number 1, how faith defines us. See, if we're going to live a life of faith, it's more than just understanding what faith is. Because faith, plain and simple, it's what we believe. What we're believing God for. It's something that we're firmly persuaded. Something that we can put our trust in. It's a conviction that moves us to action. But beyond that, when you take a look at that, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Really, that defines us as believers. It defines how we're going to live our life and what we're going to do. So I want to take apart this verse, kind of break it down a little bit. And as we go through, we're going to find out how faith really defines us. A couple of things for today, letting faith define us. First one is this. If we're going to let faith define us, first thing is that we got to build our life on it. We have to build our life on faith. If you're going to overcome in life, you're going to have to do it by building your life on faith. You're going to build a great family, have to build it by faith. You're going to build a great business, you're going to have to build it by faith. Anything that you do in life, whatever you're building on, you're going to have to build it on faith. Notice in Hebrews 11 chapter verse number 1, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. That word substance literally means a standing under. It was used in a technical sense of a title deed. So then that lets me know that our faith is the title deed to what we're believing God for. In other words, if you can see it in the Word of God, if you can find a promise, that promise, once you believe, once you have faith, that is now the title deed for what you're believing God for. We put it in natural terms that we all can understand this place. I own a home. It's my house. My name is on it, but I do have a mortgage on it. Now, even though if anything happens, the bank will take that back, and you could say, well, yeah, you know, it's the bank's really right now, and then once you pay it off, it's yours. In the technical sense, I have the title deed. That's my house. Whatever happens with it is going to be tied up with my life. And I'm paying on it in faith, believing that one day it will be paid off free and clear, and that when that day happens, it will come into my possession. Okay? Even though in the natural, I don't have the amount of money that I need to pay the entire amount now, it's something that that is a future thing, it's a future reward, that is going to be all mine, right? And that's why I'm in faith paying payments and continuing to upkeep that house and occupying that house, because that's my house. It's the same thing with faith. Whatever it is that you can see in the Word of God, maybe you're hoping to be healed. And you could just hope to be healed, or you could get in faith and let faith go to work on your hope, because faith is the substance of things hoped for. In other words, it is the concrete foundation upon which you are going to build your life. That way, if you're looking in the Word of God and you say, well, I hope to be healed, but now all of a sudden you've got a promise. By His stripes I was healed. See, that's the title deed now. It is yours. You own it. You may not see it in the natural yet, but you know that it's assured, that it's something that's going to move you forward and reach forward to grab a hold of that unseen thing, but bring it into your natural reality. Same thing with prosperity. You might hope to someday be blessed. Maybe hope someday to own a home. Maybe your hope is to purchase a car, or maybe your hope is to have enough funds that you can start up a business or something like that. And you're saying, God, I hope that I can do this. But once you get into the Word of God and you find out God takes pleasure in the prosperity of His servants, you now have the title deed that you can wrap your arms around, and you can say, now my hope has something, and now my faith is that substance of that thing, that God is going to bring that into reality, and I can now build upon the blueprint that God has laid out for me. See, if hope is the blueprint, then faith is the substance that starts to build upon that blueprint. It claims it is ours and says, yes, that's mine now. I have it. I'm going to bring that into my natural life. Let's take a look at this in the Word of God. If you have your Bibles, go with me. Remember where Hebrews 11 is. And go with me to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. Very familiar verse. Most of us in this room could probably quote it. If you can't, I would encourage you to memorize it, because it's going to bless your life. You're going to need this as you go throughout life. Look at what it says in 2 Corinthians the 5th chapter, verse number 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 7 says this: for we walk by faith and not by sight. Now, anytime you read in the Word of God that it says we walk in love, walk in peace, walk by faith. Walk means to live out your life. What are we talking about? We're talking about how faith defines us. Therefore, if our faith defines us, then we walk by faith. We live out our life by faith, not by sight. In other words, you may not see it. You may not know how it's going to happen. You may not be able to get those easy steps. But by faith now, you can walk by faith. You have the direction of God. And it's a settled, constant conviction that keeps us reaching forward to lay hold of the unseen promise of God and bring it into our natural realm. Kevin Connor said, faith stands underneath a hidden principle of the believer's life, upholding him in all trials and afflictions and throughout life itself. The New Spirit-Filled Life Bible builds on that definition, and it says it's an established conviction concerning things unseen and settled expectation of future reward. In other words, I can have what I hope for because I have the title deed, I have the Word of God, and I have faith, believing God for great things. Can you say amen today? Now listen, I shouldn't have to say this, but I do, and that is that there is a counterfeit of our faith. There's something that looks like faith, it smells like faith, but it's not faith. And that is that faith is not presumption. See, many times we've encountered believers or people around that we look at their lives and we say, you're a mess. What's going on with you? What's happening? Oh, bless God, I'm believing God. I'm in faith, and I know that God's going to bless me. And I claimed $1 million, and I know that God's going to give it to me. I'm going to be driving a Rolls Royce around here. You just wait and see. And you look at them and you go, but you're not working. You're not doing it. There's nothing happening in your life. See, that's not faith. That's presumption. And presumption says, oh, I know God can do it. I know God wants to do it. And it even may look like faith in the sense that it might be declaring and professing the promise, but on the inside, it's wavering. On the inside, it's tossed about like the waves of the ocean going back and forth, differing between two opinions. See, the Bible says if you've got doubt, you shouldn't believe that you will expect anything from the Lord. And the Bible says that you ask amiss because you ask to spend it on your own pleasures, and therefore you're not going to receive. And so we have to make sure that our heart is grounded in the Word of God and in a mature understanding of the principles of God so that we're not presumptuously saying, oh, God's going to do this. This is going to happen. I'm going to get healed. And that's presumptuous. Rather than getting in faith and saying, I believe the Word of God. I can see the promise. I have the title deed and I'm hoping for it. I'm reaching forward to it. And now I'm taking hold of it by faith and building my life on it, and God will bring it to pass. See, there's quite a difference there. Amen. You guys can see that. So first thing, defining faith, we're going to let faith define us. First thing is that we got to build our life on it. Second thing is that you have to contend for it. You have to contend for it. The moment you start to believe a promise of God and your faith, your belief, your conviction, your persuasion gets out there, and now all of a sudden you say, I believe it, I receive it, now all of a sudden all hell is going to break loose against your life. Anybody ever had that happen to them, right? It starts at the moment of salvation. You get saved, you believe God for salvation, and then all of a sudden, bang, the devil comes and tells you, you're not saved. You're a dirty old rank sinner. You got saved yesterday, and today you messed up already. It wasn't real. Must have been emotion, right? You start to believe God for finances. Start to step out in faith. God, I see in your word that you want me to be generous, to bring a tithe into the storehouse. God, I'm going to step out in faith. I believe it, therefore I'm going to put my faith to action. And you start to give, and what happens? The bottom falls out. It's like you're putting your money into a bag with holes all of a sudden, and you're going, wait a second, I never had financial problems before I tithe. So how come right now? It's because there's a trial that happens. And you're going to have to contend for your faith. Don't let the devil, don't let the world systems, don't let the flesh, don't let your relatives, your friends, people around you, co-workers, any of that, your neighbors, don't let any of that get you off of your faith. Why? Because the world systems, the devil, the flesh, it's all designed to test you, to put the pressure on so that your faith will be tested like gold. You know how gold is tested? It goes through the fire. All the impurities are burned up and taken out. And our faith is the same way. As we start to believe God, now all of a sudden, here comes the trials. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Look at the next part. The evidence of things not seen. So evidence in the sense that it can be tested. It can be cross-examined, and it can still be found faithful and constant. Now, when we use evidence, think about it this way. Evidence stands up in court. Is that right? See, if you have evidence, then that evidence, even though the defense and the prosecution can come and they can cross-examine it, that evidence won't lie. That evidence tells the truth. That evidence remains constant. And though both sides, differing sides, may come against it, may look at it, may interrogate it, may ask it questions, it's going to remain the same. And that evidence will stand up in court. Your faith will stand up in the high court of heaven. And God will look at your faith and God will say, that is what's true. Faith is what I'm about. Faith is what I'm after in my saints. Faith is what's going to get the job done. Faith, though it's cross-examined by the devil and though it gets all of the pressures and the trials on it, it will not change. It will stand up and you will see what you're believing God for. Growing up, my parents used to, we'd watch TV as a family sometimes at night, and we had one of those TVs you had to get up and turn the dial. Anybody remember that? Okay. Some of the other guys are going, what are you talking about? There's no dials on TVs. But we had to get up and click, 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 click to get to the right channel. And so, we had probably 12 or 13 channels on the TV. That was all you got, you know. And that was if you could get the wires and the coat hanger properly aligned and adjusted. You know, you had to stand on one foot and, hey, I can see it. And so we watched KDOC Channel 56, and as a public broadcast system, they had I Remember Television, some of the old shows on it, Mr. Ed, you know, we'd laugh at the talking horse and all that kind of stuff. And so we watched this one show, and I can appreciate a good courtroom drama, but CSI and Law and Order, all that kind of stuff, they don't got nothing on this old show. Anybody remember Perry Mason? Okay, good. I'm in good company today. I was kind of afraid, and it seems like as we go throughout the day, less and less people know who he is. So you're going, Pastor Dan, you're not old enough to know nothing about Perry Mason. No, I was raised as an old soul from a young age. But anyways, Perry was great, you know. It was always the same thing with Perry Mason, right? Here he is. Here comes the trial. Perry goes to court. Perry starts to argue. It looks like Perry's right, but then here comes the cross-examination, right? Here comes the other lawyer, and he comes in, and oh, my goodness, he's got something. He's got dirt. He comes in. He's ruthless. He's convicting. It looks like Perry was a fool, right? And he comes in, and it looks like Perry's backed against the wall. He's got nothing, right? Now, you know the story. You know what happens, because here comes the guy in the back, right? Perry's dude. He's coming in. He's running in with a piece of paper, waving it, looking at Perry like, come here, come here, come here. And so they run in, and Perry comes over, then they, you know, and they're looking at him. Perry, is this true? You got this? Oh, yeah, this is it right here, Perry. This is the evidence that you need, Your Honor. And all of a sudden, you know, the tide has just turned, right? Perry's got that look in his eye, and he presents the evidence. Oh, my goodness, the cross-examination, the prosecution just fell flat, and the gavel comes down, bang, not guilty. And so what happens? Perry has won the day. Oh, my goodness, you just got all blessed and filled up, and there goes the credits roll and the music and all that kind of stuff. And Perry was just the man, right? See, it's no different in our lives. You might be going in, and you might be going through a trial in life right now. Kids may have gone south. Health might have dropped out. You don't know what happened. Finances may have stopped, and it looks like the water has run dry. It looks like the devil's cross-examining your life as a Christian, and you keep coming up with failure after failure after failure, and you just can't shake loose, you can't break free. But I'm here to tell you something, that the promise of God is coming in the back. There is a paper, a title deed that's coming in, and it's now on your side, and it's in your favor, and it doesn't matter the cross-examination that you go through in life, that evidence will stand up in court, and you will be declared victorious. You are a winner. You are an overcomer. You are blessed of God. You are healed and whole. You are prosperous and of good success, because God is on your side, and He is faithful to His word, and you can believe God for great things. Hallelujah. You're there in 2 Corinthians? All right, I want you guys to turn with me for a second. 1 Timothy, take a look at this. We're talking about contending for the faith. 1 Timothy. Apostle Paul's writing to a young pastor named Timothy. He's giving him instructions. And in 1 Timothy chapter number 6, I'm going to take a look at another very familiar verse, but it's a verse that we need to get a hold of in our lives. Because the trials are coming, church, when you need to be strong, you need to be steady. You need to have the word of God, the promise of God that you can believe God for. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse number 12, look at what it says. He says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called, and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. See, you're going to have to fight for it, because you can't calculate it. You can't see it. You can't determine how it's going to come about. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. I was having a conversation with Pastor Jim this past week, and he said something that just went off on the inside of me, and I was like, man, I got to share that with the church. And here's what he said to me. He said, faith doesn't really begin until you don't understand. Faith doesn't really even begin until you don't understand. Listen, I don't know how I got saved when I prayed a prayer and gave my heart and life to Jesus. I don't know what He did to make me born again. But by faith, I believe that I'm saved and that I'm headed for heaven. Oftentimes, when my wife and I, when we look over the finances, we're not going to make it. We don't know how it's going to happen. But we tithe in faith. We are generous in faith. We believe God. There's been times where we have had no money and God says, give. We look at each other and my wife will say, honey, God just told me. I said, don't even tell me. Just do it and we'll see what happens, you know. But it's by faith. God always works it out. See, faith doesn't really begin until you don't understand. And the cross-examination will come. There's going to be trials. There's going to be pressures. But if you can fight the good fight of faith, you're going to come out on the other side. See, we don't need to support our faith. You don't need to go out and find proof for your proof. Are you listening? You don't need evidence for your evidence. Your evidence is the evidence. So we don't need to support our faith. We need our faith to support us. Hallelujah. A couple of things today. Letting our faith define us. First thing, build your life on it. Second thing, contend for it. Last one for today is live by it. If you're going to live a life, you're going to have to live a life of faith. Hebrews chapter 11 alone, the term by faith or through faith, I counted it up in the New King James Version 25 times. 25 times in one chapter alone, by faith or through faith. See, do you think that God is trying to tell us something? God wants us to live a life of faith. We were in Hebrews the 10th chapter. Turn there back with me. Hebrews the 10th chapter. We had come to a verse that I said, the first part of the verse we were going to come back to when we hit Hebrews the 11th chapter, because it was about faith. Hebrews the 10th chapter, verse number 38 says this. It says, now the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. See, God is not pleased when we draw back from the promises of God. God is not pleased when we get out of faith. One of the most convicting verses to me in the entire Bible is in Romans, the 14th chapter, verse number 23. Right at the very end, it says, everything that does not come from faith is sin. Oh, God, help us. Lord, help us in our unbelief. Help us to believe, God. Far be it from me to sin against you by not believing you at your word. Oh, God, I want to live a life of faith. We must have a constant interaction with the invisible realm. See, we can't see it. We can't calculate it, but you got to live by it. You got to believe that God, who is the invisible God, is still the almighty God. That even though you don't know what Jesus looks like in the natural, that you can see him high and lifted up at the right hand of power, interceding on your behalf. Even though you can't touch or taste or smell the Holy Ghost, you know that he's working in you, leading you, guiding you, counseling you, comforting you, teaching you. See, we must have a constant interaction with the supernatural realm. Rick Renner, who's a missionary in Russia, said this. He said, faith is the spark that ignites the impossible and causes it to become possible. This is a man who was told, you can't build a church in Moscow. You can't do anything in Russia. They're still watching. The KGB hasn't fully disbanded. They're still going after churches, and yet he's been able to do great and mighty, wonderful things, build great churches all over Russia, doing a missionary work. Why? Because he had faith. We were praying for Officer Garcia. You remember Officer Garcia? San Bernardino Police Department, on life support, couldn't talk, couldn't walk, saying it didn't look good. Last week, I got an update from Chaplain Ray. He's sitting right here. Okay, Officer Garcia, hold on. Wave at me if this is true. He's up talking and walking. Is that right? Walking miracle. Walking miracle. How does that happen? Because prayers of faith went up from we believed God, and out of that unseen realm, we grabbed a hold of it by faith in our prayers, and we brought it into the natural realm, and God placed that in his body, that healing power, and now he's a walking miracle because of faith. Got to live a life by faith. Can't look at the natural, can't look at the circumstances. You know, we're in freedom for our future right now. Capital stewardship campaign, going to pay the church off. You say, Pastor, how's that going to happen? Uh-oh. Because right now, let me tell you, in the natural right now, we're at 25%, even though we're halfway through the campaign. Right now, we're at 75% pledged, even though we should be at 100% pledged. So, Pastor, what's going to happen? I don't know. God is going to happen. My faith is believing God that somehow either big gifts are going to come in, or a lot of little gifts are going to come in, or at the end of it all, we're going to be standing there scratching our heads saying, nothing came in, but somehow it's paid. Glory to God. Let's go burn the mortgage. See, God's going to do something great, but you got to believe him. You got to believe him. I want to close with this. I was so blessed. Pastor Mike Bryan sent across an email, and I met the guy last service. He attends this church and had a great testimony. He says this, in 2006, I was woke up at 2 a.m. by my father, who was praying and worshiping the Lord. He woke me up that morning, and after prayer and conversation, I rededicated my life to the Lord. Now, Pastor Luke actually attended school with this guy and said this guy was like the hoodlum of the school, right? Bad news, intimidating, just not a nice guy. And so here he is in 2006. He rededicates his heart to the Lord. And then he writes, says, later that afternoon, okay, so he just believed God for something, rededicated his life to the Lord. That afternoon, my parents left to visit an uncle in Lancaster. One of my buddies wanted to learn how to ride a motorcycle, so we went to the hills behind where I live to ride. It was the day after it rained, so the ground was loose. I gave him all the equipment, the helmet, the pads, and let him take off. After a while, I wanted to show him how not to be afraid, so I took off with no helmet or anything on besides sweats and an undershirt. Okay, now I understand faith, but I also understand wisdom. Okay? The last thing that I remember was the back of the bike getting wobbly. I crashed. I went over a little cliff and landed directly on my neck and head. As soon as I crashed, by the grace of God, an RN happened to see me. Is that a coincidence? An RN happened to see me and opened my airway. Both of my lungs had collapsed. The ambulance rushed me to the Loma Linda trauma unit. By the time my parents got there, I was in a coma, eyes taped shut, and a tag on my toe. Can I tell you something? When you got a tag on your toe, that's it. You're done, right? No mas. My head was swollen up three times its normal size, and I was bleeding out of my eyes. I was living on a machine, life support, and I believe since I was a donor, they were keeping me alive. The doctors, police, and other family members proceeded to tell my parents that I was dead, and if I was to stay on life support, I would be a vegetable for the rest of my life. Now, I want you to notice the faith. My parents refused to believe anyone, knowing Jesus had the final say. They laid hands on me and spoke life, standing in agreement that I would live and not die. 6 hours later, I rose up out of the bed, pulled the life support out of my mouth, saying, "You can bruise my body, but you can't have my soul, devil. I am a soldier in the army of the Lord." Wow. He concludes the email saying, "It's now 2015. All glory to God. I'm completely fine with no medical problems at all." And I saw him at the back door today, alive, smiling, praising God. Church, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And so if we're going to let faith define us, we got to, number one, build our life on it. Number two, you're going to have to contend for it. You're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. And number three, you got to live a life by faith. Come on, can we give the Lord a great big praise today? Hallelujah. God is good. You guys have been great today. I want to thank you guys for remaining seated. Those of you guys that are leaving right now, listen up, okay? If you're in the foyer, hey, take a moment, listen up. God wants to speak to your life right where you're at. If you're out there in the breezeways, come on, either come back into the foyer where it's warm, or if you don't mind being cold, sit out there and listen up. God wants to speak to you. But I ask everybody, remain seated during this time. Come on, don't get up, don't pass out. No, stop texting, okay? It's over. Let's focus in, because God wants to speak to you right where you're at right now. Let the ushers do their job. They're going to finish up, and they're going to head out. But just give me a couple more minutes of your attention, then we'll let you go. I want to make sure that as you leave this place, that your heart's right with God, because it'd be a tragedy for me to let you go right now. And if your heart wasn't right with God, and God forbid anything should happen to you, but if today was your last day on earth and you closed your eyes here in life and opened your eyes in eternity, I would want you at the end of it all, and I know you would want this too, I would want you to go to heaven and not go to hell. Now, sometimes people say, "Well, Pastor, hold on a second, because I don't believe in hell. That's not real." You know, parents made up this fairy tale called hell in order to scare their children into being good. And I don't think that God, a loving God, would send people to hell. Well, he doesn't, first of all. Hell was never intended for you and me. It was made for the devil and his angels that rebelled. And yet it's a very real place. The Bible talks about it, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of it. It's a very real place. You can't just ignore it and think that it's going to go away. That's like burying your head in the sand and expecting not to get touched by the wind. You're going to have to deal with the reality of hell. And I don't want you to go there. You don't want you to go there. And listen, God even doesn't want you to go there. But he's a just God. And therefore, he allows us the free will choice to choose with our life where we're going to go, whether it be heaven or whether it's going to be hell. Sometimes people say, "Well, Pastor, I don't have to worry about hell, even though it might be a real place. I don't have to worry about it because, you know, all roads lead to heaven. You just do whatever you want to do. I'll do what I want to do." The churches out there, they're all well-meaning, and therefore, you know, they can do whatever they want to do. But, you know, we're all going to make it somehow, some way. But can I say something to you? It's like saying all roads lead to the moon. Listen, you can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you will never make it to the moon. In the same way, what makes us think that we can do whatever we want to do, and we're going to get to heaven? Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me." What's that mean? It means it's God's heaven. You're going to have to get there God's way. And don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross, don't you think after he did all that he would tell us how to get to heaven? Well, he does in his word. Sometimes people say, "Well, Pastor, I agree with that because God lets good people into heaven. All you got to do is be good. I've been good, been nice to my neighbors, help people out, give money to charities. My good outweighs my bad. Used to be bad, cleaned up my act, now I'm good. God's going to let me into heaven because I've been good." Well, my question back to you is, how good do you have to be to get to heaven? Is there a grading scale? Is there a line or a curve that you have to be above in order to get into heaven? Does your good have to outweigh your bad? Where do you see that in the Bible? Can you show that to me? You know what I see in the Bible? The standard of how good you have to be is perfection if you're going to make it there on your own merit. The only one who was perfect was Jesus. And the Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Not going to make it there based on your goodness, because your goodness compared to God's goodness, the Bible says, like filthy rags, going to get thrown out. Not going to make it to heaven just by being good. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, you don't understand. I was raised in church. Parents told me we were Christians growing up. I consider myself to be a Christian. Went to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. Parents hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child? And you're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religion. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Doesn't that mean that we're Christians headed for heaven? Well, no, it doesn't. Because did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you're raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend religious classes, wear religious jewelry, or be baptized or christened as a child that you get to go to heaven? It's not there. I don't see anywhere in the Bible because you're born in America or because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your life. Today, will you let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth? You're not going to make it if that's how you think you're going to get there. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I understand that, but not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now. I'm sitting right in front of you. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian? Well, you know what that's like saying? That's like me saying, you know, I'm a Dodger, and therefore I go and I sit in the Dodgers dugout, wear the Dodger uniform, bring my bat and my ball, and think that I'm going to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen to me? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I am not a Dodger. Can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Sometimes people say, well, okay, Pastor, but you don't understand. My last church I got involved, you're talking about volunteerism. I volunteered. I helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader, even got a membership card to that church. It's great. Glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible where your volunteerism gets you into heaven. God's not counting your volunteer hours or what you do in order to get into heaven. That's back to good works. Nowhere in the Bible is God looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. You say, Pastor, okay, I understand all that, but I got you on this one. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? I can quote scriptures to you, Pastor. And while that's great, I'm glad you can do those things. If you'd read your Bible, you know demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The devil himself knows and believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and yet he's not a Christian, even though he can quote scriptures out of his mouth. So everybody look up here. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that makes you right with God. See, that's back to presumption. Looks like faith, but it's not real faith. But rather, God is looking after your heart. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They raked it through the coals, made it out to be some weirdo, goofy thing that no one wants. But listen, let's not let Hollywood movie, televisions, books, and the internet in our society define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Because you've got to be born again to enter the kingdom of heaven. No other way you're going to do it except God's way. God's way is you must be born again. So what does that mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Have you given him all of your heart? Have you given him all of your life? Because if not, I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. All or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. In the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to the church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says these words. He says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. What's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. Here's your opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You say, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's get over that today. Because I want you to think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? And no one make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God? Come on. And yet the devil's going to come and cross-examine your faith right now. He's going to try and talk you out of it. Your flesh is going to rise up and say, oh, no, I can't do this. I'm scared. But listen, no one's judging you. No one's criticizing you. No one's condemning you. We all have done this before, and now it's your turn. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better. Today, who should raise your hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today's your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand? You've never done this before. Never gave God all of your heart and all of your life. Come on, I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get right with God, acknowledging your need for Jesus by simply raising your hand. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or online, wherever you're at, listen, God sees, God knows right now where you're at if you're getting ready to raise your hand. And then right after you do that, you can click the button that says respond to God or go to our homepage, How to Know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. If you're on campus, you're out there in the foyer, down there at the Love Rock Cafe, telling us you're right afterwards, or come into the church service. You guys ready? I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. If you're in any of those categories I described, get ready to get your hand up all together. If you need to do this on the count of three. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. Six. Thank you. Seven. Got you over there. Seven wise people up in the family room. Anybody? Seven up on top. Seven, eight. Got you up there. Thank you. Eight wise people on this side. On this side. Nine. Got you over there. Ten. Got you. Anyone else? Real quick. Ten wise people. Anybody that I didn't already see, you're saying, I wanted to do this. Ten. 11. Thank you. Got you over there. Anybody else? 12, got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. 13 over there. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? About 13 wise people. Don't you just know there's number 14 and number 15? You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. So God's tugging at your heart right now. If you can feel that tug, you know God's speaking to you. Just raise your hand right now. You're saying, yeah, I need to do this. I need to give God all my heart. I need to give God all of my life. Anybody else real quick? Thank you. 14. Come on, number 15. Thank you, 15. Okay, number 16 over here. Where you at? Just raise it up high. Give me a little wave if I can't see you. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 15 wise people. Hallelujah. Now, all 15 of you, or there's five more of you that should have raised your hand, but you didn't. So all 20 of you, actually. Why don't you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. So get a hold of your stuff. What have you brought with you to church? Get a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle, meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. Now, listen, no one leaves during this time. This is very rude if you walk out right now. Listen, the people that are trying to come forward, they're going to walk out with you. I'm trying to get them to come down here and get a life change, all right? So let's all stand and welcome them. And if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come. Get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front right now. You come right now. Come on. Come on down. Just as you are. Hallelujah. They're coming. This miracle. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Just as you are. From the family rooms, you can bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on down. Come on down. Come receive. From the foyer. Come on in. Come back in. Hallelujah. Forever. Even if you didn't raise your hand, you just come right now. Come on, take the first step.
Everlasting, He'll give you strength for Jesus.
Come on down, come on down. If that's you, just and get out in the aisle. Meet me up front right now. Come on down.
Water.
They're still coming. They're still
and
coming.
Never thirst.
You can come too.
Again.
Hallelujah. Hey, everybody up front, look up here. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Going to be born again, headed for heaven. That's the best decision of your entire life, all right? Now, I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine. See this guy waving at you over here up on the step? That's Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on, okay? Sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to get today. He's cool, all right? He's going to do three things. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance so you're not wondering or concerned, okay? He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, easy reading to help find out what to do next in your walk with God. Then finally, he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church in a program that we call Spiritual Personal Trainers, all right? Basically, it's a friend in church who come alongside you for 5 weeks, teach you five things out of the Bible, just like a physical trainer helps you get strong at the gym. Spiritual Personal Trainer does that for you spiritually. So you don't go back to the old ways and to the old man. You go on in faith, believing God for great things, all right? Then he'll let you come right back out. Now listen, I want to make a promise to you guys. Here's the promise. Give us a year. 1 year of your life sitting under the teaching consistently here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. You can get here Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Come on. Maybe you can't come Sunday. Come Saturdays. Maybe you can't come Saturdays. Come Sunday night at 6. Come Wednesday night. Maybe you can get a couple in. Maybe you can get here for the women's Bible study Thursday morning at 9:30 or young adult service Friday night at 7. Whatever you can do, get as much as you can. And after that year and for the rest of your life, here's the promise. I guarantee that you're going to look around your life and say, oh my goodness, I didn't know I could be this blessed. But tell them the truth. All right, take their word for it, okay? So, you guys are making a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give them a hand as they go. Hallelujah! Woo!
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.